basically they are testing your quality because you are going to be the administrator. Please remember, they ask you economy. They ask you about law, sociology, geography, so that you can understand the context of any event and draw from the legitimacy of any government action, its acceptability. And then there is diplomacy, international relations, security, etc. And all these factors have always been important in the context of empires. And as we will see in a few minutes, how Mughal Empire's decline was related to these factors. Mughal Empire was a vast power, a major power in the Indian subcontinent. But because there started creeping in many problems in these four factors, they started going into a decline. And that is where we are going to focus on in this lecture. First, let's talk about the ruler. The attitude of a ruler, their behavior, their characteristics, their attitude, their ethics impact the destiny of any empire, whichsoever empire it might be. So we had great rulers like Akbar in Mughal Empire. So during their time, the Mughal Empire flourished. But after the death of Aurangzeb, there were succession wars. There were many contenders to the throne and they were fighting against each other. And all these rulers were unworthy and weak. What do you mean by weak? For example, and this is exactly written in NCERT. I'm just trying to help you how to understand these things. Jalandhar Shah. He was completely lacking in dignity and decency. Can there ever be a ruler who is lacking in decency and people are going to accept that ruler? It is impossible. Similarly, Farrukh Siyad, he became the Mughal emperor during 1710s, but he was coward, cruel, undependable. If you are not dependable, how is the public going to trust you? Similarly, Muhammad Shah Rangila. During the Muhammad Shah Rangila's reign, Delhi was attacked by Nadir Shah, but he was so fond of luxury, he was simply not there. He was not able to rise to the occasion to take charge in his hand. Therefore, because Aurangzeb was succeeded by all these weak and unworthy rulers, this became a major drawback of the Mughal Empire and contributed to its decline. In fact, because the rulers were not worthy enough, it led to rise of regional kings and king makers. For example, there were Sayyid brothers in the Mughal Empire who became so powerful that they even killed Farrukh Siyad. So you can imagine that how what havoc can a weak ruler can impose on any empire. So this is the first factor which led to the decline of Mughal Empire, the rulers, unworthy rulers. Next, the economy. We all remember that Raja Todarmal during the reign of Akbar had a very sound revenue mechanism. Because this revenue mechanism was very sound, the finances of the Mughal Empire were very strong. But during the reign of Aurangzeb, the royal coffers were completely emptied. And why were they emptied? Because Aurangzeb started a very costly struggle in the Deccan. All of you know that war is not cheap. For waging a war, you have to pay the soldiers. You have to pay for the ammunition. You have to pay to feed them. And if you are continuously waging war, your economy is going to become weakened. Therefore, during the reign of Aurangzeb itself, the Mughal economy was crumbling. And then there was wasteful expenditure in the form of Taj Mahal and Bibi Ka Maqbara. And as if this was not enough, during the high power of Marathas, Even the Chauth and Sabdeshmukhi were granted to Marathas. So it became a loss for the Mughal revenue. What is Chauth? Chauth is 1/4 of the revenue of the produce that comes from agriculture. So if 1/4 of the produce is going to Marathas, then what exactly is left for Mughals? Almost nothing. Similarly, Sardeshmukhi was a further 10% levy. So all these were a heavy drain on the revenues of Mughal Empire. And this was leading to the weakening of their economy. And then when the rulers are weak, they start granting jagirs to their courtiers. And if they're granting jagirs recklessly, it is going to empty the coffers again. So because of all these things, and because there were no new scientific developments to help with the increase of production, Mughal Empire's economy was constantly in decline, which played a major role in the decline of Mughal Empire. And all these factors, as I earlier mentioned, the weakening of rulers, the economy, they were all coming together at the start of the 18th century, especially after the death of Aurangzeb in 1707. Then, important factor, legitimacy and law. What is exactly legitimacy? Legitimacy is when the ruler takes an action and public accepts it, not because the ruler is powerful, because the public feels that it is the right decision. That is the legitimacy, when public accepts. And if the public is not accepting it, then sooner or later, there will be rebellions. There will be alternative leaders. There will be mutiny. Therefore, it is very important that public of any empire accepts the government as legitimate. And how does that legitimacy comes? Through law, through socially sanctioned legislations. But you must realize that due to the strong rule of rulers like Akbar, Jahangir, Mughal Empire enjoyed a great prestige. In fact, it is due to the prestige that the Mughal, even though they became weak, their rule continued till 1857. So this is, you must realize that Mughal Empire's legitimacy was very strong. And this was perhaps the only saving grace for Mughal Empire. We studied a fourfold structure. This was the only point which was left and which was not weakened. For example, Farrukh Shiar, during his reign, issued some dastaks. Dastaks were passes. If you show that dastak, you won't have to pay the custom duty. And those dastaks, as we will later see, became the cause of the Battle of Plassey, because the dastak of the Mughal emperor was so strong that no ruler could refuse to accept it. Similarly, their legitimacy was so strong that even though the Nawabs of Hyderabad and Bengal, they were practically independent, but still they used to choose rule in the name of Mughal emperor. Mughal emperor had so much legitimacy. They had established a system which continued, for example, Mansabdari system. Similarly, India, as all of you know, in fact, there have been movies in the name of Namak Halal and Namak Haram. In India, Namak Halali is very important. You do not go disloyal against the salt. So Mughals were so legitimate that nobody resisted them, because loyalty to the Mughals was a matter of loyalty to the salt. So this factor was an important factor that Mughals did not crumble immediately, even though all other factors were weak. They had weak rulers, weak economy. But then the last part did the major blow against the Mughal Empire. They had weak diplomacy. Howsoever strong you are, if you do not know how to make friends, whether you work in corporate or in civil services or anywhere, you should know how to make friends. And Aurangzeb did not have that art. In fact, all of us know the story when Shivaji actually went to the court of Aurangzeb, but instead of giving him a high mansab and placating his ambition, he actually arrested Shivaji. If you have such bad diplomacy, if you are not able to make friends with a strong person like Shivaji, then ultimately you are going to pay for it. Then, because of the bad diplomacy, they reversed the policy of religious tolerance and reimposed jizya and pilgrim tax. So because of that, the discontent in the empire started increasing. The discontent increased, their number of friends decreased, and finally, they, in the reign of Aurangzeb, Guru Tegh Bahadur Ji was killed, and it started a long struggle with Sikhs in the north. So if you do not have friends, you are going to continuously fight with enemies, and that is going to lead to the decline of your empire. And that becomes very important. So now we have seen four factors which together led to the decline of Mughal empire, and that created a power vacuum which was filled by the Europeans. This power vacuum was first filled by many regional kings. For example, there was rise of Nawabs in Bengal, Awadh, Hyderabad. There was rise of Marathas. Then there was rise of Tipu Sultan and his father Hyder Ali in Mysore. There was independent kingdom of Punjab. Please, you should note that there was a time when there was the reign of Mughal emperor in all these parts. But because they lagged on those four factors, these regional kings started having aspirations of having independent empires. Then whatever small legitimacy was left, attack of Nadir Shah and the resultant massacre in Delhi destroyed it. Just imagine, there is Mughal emperor seated in Delhi and a foreign ruler is carrying out a massacre of the population of Delhi. It is going to completely erode the legitimacy of Mughal emperor. And that was a big factor. After the attack of Nadir Shah, everyone in the Indian subcontinent knew that Mughal empire has lost its former glory. And as I earlier described, there was rise of kingmakers and powerful nobles in the Mughal court. And all these conditions finally led to the decline. And it created space for the European powers to rise, and they made the most out of it. So Europeans in India, when did they start coming in India? It was not that British came here and they were the first who came to India. The contacts with the British and the Europeans, French, Dutch, it was being carried out for a very long time. In fact, there are major historical travelogues written by a French person, Francois Bernier, who was present in Delhi at the time of the reign of Shah Jahan. So Europeans were in contact with the India for a very long time. But then there came a moment when the conditions became ripe for the rise of European power in India, which you must please pay attention to, because this is very critical. There were many European contenders for power in India, but only English won this war. And the answer why English won this war and not the French or the Dutch, that is what we are going to focus next. So we talked about four factors: ruler, economy, legitimacy, and diplomacy. Let's apply those factors for the French struggle in India. First, they had exemplary commander, Dupleix. In fact, it was the Dupleix who propounded the theory of divide and rule. Divide and rule, all of us know. But it was actually a French person, French commander Dupleix, who propounded this theory. And because of the importance of this great commander, when finally there was Treaty of Paris, the first demand that the English made to the French is take back this person. Because a good commander, a good ruler can transform the fortunes of your empire. And that was exactly what the Dupleix was doing. He was the one who propounded most of the concepts of divide and rule, of subsidiary alliance. All those basics were the brainchild of a great person like Dupleix. Then, economy. This was a weak factor for the French East India Company because it was dependent on its for its funds on the French ruler. As all of us know, because of the history of French Revolution, that French kings were not very strong. In fact, they were used to luxury and comfort. They were not foresighted rulers who can transform the fate of any failing empire. Therefore, it becomes important that we know that French East India Company was dependent on the French ruler for its finances. And it could not be but harmful for the fate of the French East India Company. But there was another factor. As they were foreigners, naturally Indians resisted their rule. It is in the nature of every person that they do not submit to the rule of an outsider. And you cannot suppress that spirit for long. It was the legitimacy of the French people, which was very low. So therefore, they could not depend on the loyalty of the Indian people as Mughals did. So they understood it very clearly from the very start, and they focused on give and take, on the divide and rule from the very start. And this was the reason for their success. They understood that they are weak on some points. They understood that they are not going to enjoy the legitimacy that Mughal rulers do. So they will have to depend on some other tactics. But they were very strong on the diplomacy front. This is something extremely important, diplomacy. They had an alliance with Muzaffar Jung of Hyderabad and Chanda Sahib of Karnataka. They were the, as I mentioned here, they were the first to have this policy divide and rule. So they clearly made treaties with Indian rulers so that they can turn them against their own countrymen. So are you seeing where it is going? They are already dividing Indian people by entering into treaties with some Indian rulers and fighting wars against other Indian rulers. So this was a critical factor for the rising power of French in India. But the French could not survive because first, their economy was very weak. Dependent on their funds. Any person who is dependent on the funds on someone else, that person cannot be successful. Why is India today focusing on economy? Why is Prime Minister Modi talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat? Because the nations which are dependent on the finances of someone else cannot be successful. That is the importance of self-reliance. And French East India Company was not self-reliant. They were dependent on the French king, as we will see later again. But now contrast the French East India Company to the East India Company. Obviously, Mughal Empire was in decline. And French on one hand and British on one hand were struggling for the power in India. But French became failure and British became a success. Because they had matching commanders, Robert Clive. If they had duplex, British had Robert Clive, a very young, energetic and smart person. He was the one who very cleverly used Indians against Indians. So they had good commanders. Then they were not dependent on the British Emperor for the funds. They clearly worked on the basis of principle of profit. We should remember that this was the time when in Britain, Adam Smith was writing about invisible hands of markets. Even today, most of the economics that we study in our textbooks holds the fundamentals from the books of Adam Smith. So they were very ahead in terms of the economic principles they were following. They were a very important rising economic power. Then they not only relied on their own legitimacy, because they knew they are foreigners. So they used the legitimacy of Mughal emperor to pursue their own ends. For example, they got their dastaks. They got the dastaks from the Mughal emperor that added to the legitimacy of the British in India. They started translating works of Indian languages into English so that they can understand what Indian people think, how they think, what are their customs. If you want to conquer any people, you have to understand them how they think. Are you getting my point? If you want to conquer any new civilization, any new people, you have to understand how they think. So you read about James Prinsep, who translated Mauryan script. So all these developments were happening simultaneously. They were using every way. They were taking the authority of Mughal emperor by getting farmans from them, royal farmans. They were also translating Indian works into English so that they can better understand how Indians participate, how Indians think. And then finally, they were extremely brilliant in terms of diplomacy because they were using divide and rule policy, and they made peace with who was stronger than them, and they bribed Nizam to tackle people. For example, there was a time when British in the south were facing the combined power of Mysore, Marathas and Hyderabad. So now British knew that they are weak. They cannot tackle all these powers simultaneously. So what they did was they entered into a treaty of Salbai with Marathas. Treaty of Salbai with Marathas, and they bribed Nizam so that they can focus on their main opponent, who is Tipu Sultan. This was their diplomacy. When to make friends with, who to fight against. So when they thought they are weak, they did not fight against strong people. They fought against limited number of enemies. And this was the major contributor of their success. And this is how they pursued their causes, and this is how they were exactly in the position to dominate India, because they stood on the front of good rulers, good economic principles, good legitimacy through the Mughal Empire and understanding Indians and Indian society and diplomacy. So because of that, British were in the perfect position to win India. And then the Anglo-Carnatic Wars started, which was basically a struggle between British and French, and they together fought the war for Indian Empire. How did Anglo-Carnatic Wars started? Anglo-Carnatic Wars started because of the death of Nizam in Hyderabad. Death of Nizam in Hyderabad led to a succession war between Muzaffar Jung and Nasir Jung. Muzaffar Jung was the grandson of Nizam, and Nasir Jung was the son of Nizam. So there was a struggle between them for the Hyderabad Nawabship. Similarly, there was Chanda Sahib in Karnataka who was conspiring against Nawab Anwaruddin. And French, in these circumstances, took the advantage of this condition and they started supporting Muzaffar Jung to become Nizam. And the new Nizam gave them Pondicherry and Masulipatnam to French. So we can see here that how the divide and rule policy was already manifested. So they had supported one ruler, Muzaffar Jung, in his struggle for Nizamship, and in return, French got Pondicherry and Masulipatnam. And that's why even today we remember that Pondicherry was a French territory. So they got it from the Nizam of Hyderabad. But this was the peak of French power because they were able to win on many, many fronts. In Karnataka, Nawab Anwaruddin was killed by the three allies. Those three allies are Chanda Sahib, Muzaffar Jung, and French. They together killed Nawab Anwaruddin, and son of Nawab fled to Trichinopoly. Similarly, in Hyderabad also, Muzaffar Jung was made the new Nizam and Nasir Jung was killed. And even after the Muzaffar Jung was killed, the Bassi was a French officer who was placed in the Hyderabad as resident. He similarly made Salabat Jung the French puppet in the Hyderabad, and Salabat Jung became the Nizam. Therefore, you can see that how French were already exercising authority on who is going to become Nizam and who is not going to become Nizam. But it is not that British were very silent in all this. In fact, British won the Battle of Plassey in the midst of the struggle against the French. In fact, as I mentioned in this slide, the Battle of Plassey, which was in Bengal, it turned the tide for the British people. Because of the Battle of Plassey, so many resources came at the disposal of the British Empire, British company, that they were easily able to swipe against the French army. And in all this, Robert Clive was very critical for the British ambitions. Robert Clive attacked Arpad when son of Nawab Anwaruddin was surrounded and released him. So this was the first major failure of French. They were not able to kill the son of Anwaruddin, and hence the Carnatic went out of their hands. Similarly, little support by French government to French East India Company, as I was already mentioning. If you are dependent on finances on someone else, then you are not going to go very far in your ambitions. Then in 1754, French agreed to call Dupleix. So British very smartly got the best commander of the French out of the sea. And Battle of Plassey brought economy into their favor. And finally, in the Battle of Vendivash, this is very important to remember from a prelims point of view. In the Battle of Vendivash, Sir Eyre Coote defeated the French forces. In fact, this Battle of Vendivash was so decisive that the general of French army, General Lally, was brought to death in the France. Sir Eyre Coote of British army defeated General Lally of French army, and General Lally for this defeat was brought to death in the France because of this major defeat. And this way, British became the sole contenders of European powers in the Indian subcontinent. In the next lecture, we are going to cover how the decline of Mughal Empire led to the rise of regional kingdoms, as I earlier described. And finally, I would like to leave you with a note that it is your attitude not your aptitude, that will determine your success. If you are not dedicated enough, if you are not committed enough for the success, then you cannot achieve success, howsoever good your aptitude may be. So you have to be disciplined. You have to be regular with your studies. You have to get the right guidance for your success. On this note, I would like to thank again the officers' classes for giving me an opportunity to share with you my thoughts. Thank you.